no chill in my mind. I can't find the way out of here. I want you by my side so that I never feel alone again. Love, won't you? We can bring it on the floor. Never danced like this before. We don't talk about it. Dance on.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble, it might drag you down. Know you're not alone.
everyone was on our side. Then we grew a little and romanticized the time I saw flowers in your hair. Cause it takes a boy to live, takes a man to pretend he was there. So then we grew a little and knew a lot, and now we demonstrated it to the cops. And all the things we said, we were self-assured. Cause it's a long road to wisdom, but it's a short one to being ignored. Be in my eyes, be in my heart, be in my eyes.
This man will try and speak my mind. It's hard to find your way without a lie. When we drink wine, you have a way to slow the motion in my mind. All the while can turn me back to you in mid-flight. It's hard to find your way without a lie. Ooh. What's the point in living out my days without you? Towards the sky, look to find a sign to tell me where to fly. The birds that soar above don't need a reason why. It's hard to find your way without a light. What's the point in living out my days without you?
Run, run, don't trail behind. Keep moving, the beast won't stop till we're dead. All the scrapes on our knees will tell you where we've been, where we have bled. How we play, autumn days,
only on the instant, the day is one. Won't stop
all creatures of the sun. We're all children of the day. We're just chasing what we can ever get.
Clouds, whoa, oh, 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 whoa, oh, oh, oh. second, I need to get my story straight. My friends are in the bathroom getting higher than the Empire State. My lover, she is waiting for me just across the bar. My seat's been taken by some sunglasses asking about a scar, and I know I gave it to you months ago. I know you're trying to forget, but between the drinks and subtle things, the holes in my apologies, you know, I'm trying hard to take it back. So if by the time the bar closes and you feel like falling down.
Friends, please find your table and be seated. We will begin the 12th annual CUJDC luncheon in just a moment.
Bar closes and you feel like falling down, I'll carry you home tonight.
Held on hold like a new, like a rope, got a medicine, take no mercy on him, poisoned his blood, and burned out his throat, enough is enough, he's a long way from home. Days of my youth wasted on selfish food. Ran for the hills from the hand you were dealt. I flew far away, as far as I could go.
Your time is running out, and I'm a long way from you. Laid up in bed, you laid up in bed, holding the pain like you're holding your breath. I prayed you could sleep, sleep like a stone. You're right next to me, but you're a long way from home. Hospital gowns never fit like they should. We yelled at the nurse, didn't do any good. More morphine. The last words you moaned, at last I was sure that you weren't far away.
Friends, please take your seats. Our program is about to begin.
Hundred thousand miles of lonely track, holding back tomorrow. Someday I'll hop along and ride it home. But old ties and companions, we never leave alone. So old man, give me endless time. Never let these ties sever. Cause heaven knows in all this fooling realm, these times won't last forever after all.
Feeling low as I piece together my night. Where and when Was I wrong? Am I ever right? So I wait like a dog who is on his call, like a stray. Won't go back, running down fall.
I was wrong when I met you, honey. Up above, yeah, I placed you there. Only love can cure my madness. Only love is my repair. Is my repair.
As I go, well, the time's rolling on. And I don't know where I was when it all went wrong. So I wait like a dog who is on his call, like a stray.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our MC for the CUJDC Luncheon, Reggie Rivers.
Hey, thank you for that smattering of applause. I mean, thank you so much. Listen, somebody was asking me just a few minutes ago. I'm Reggie Rivers, former Denver Bronco, and someone asked me if I played with John Elway, and I said yes, John Elway played during the Reggie Rivers era. It was some of his most successful years, if you don't count those two Super Bowls that he won. So, hey, it's really an honor and a privilege to be here. I have been a part of this event for the past, I don't know, 5 or 6 years, but this is the first time we've been all back in this room together since 2019. We've done virtual events in 2020 and 2021 right here in this room, but it was just the Sewell Ballroom AV team and the leadership at the Johnson Depression Center. And now to have all of you here with us, it is wonderful. Thank you for being here. So this is the 12th annual Helen and Arthur E. Johnson Depression Center Luncheon. And we have all of you here in person. We also have people who are joining us online. So hello to all of you who are joining us from home. We appreciate that. We are here to tackle stigma, and we appreciate all of you being here to help communicate that message. In a few minutes, you're going to hear powerful advocates and their stories about why speaking up about mental health is so important now and how it makes a difference in our community. But first, we want to take a moment to recognize our sponsors, and we're going to recognize them rather than just clapping continuously like you're at a State of the Union address. We're going to recognize them in a significant way in football. In football, if you're in the huddle and a quarterback called a play like red, right, trips, flat, op, X, post, Z, waggle, H, and Y, switch, on one, ready? You would clap on ready. Ready? Ready? One synchronized clap, ready? Ready? Oh, look at you. Oh, the buffs, you guys are ready. So we're going to give one synchronized clap to each of our sponsors, starting with the University of Colorado Foundation. Ready? The Anschutz Foundation. Ready? The Pflug Family Foundation. Ready? Don't get ahead of them. The Fox Tejero Family Charitable Fund. Ready? Sue and Walt Rakowicz. Ready? The Uyghurs Family Foundation. Ready? Okay, I've got to pause and read carefully. The Boehringer Ingelheim Pharmaceutical, ready? Our field goal sponsor, RK Foundation, ready? Red Zone sponsor, Brown & Company, Inc., ready? The Frederick C. Hamilton Family Foundation, ready? Sharon and Lanny Martin, ready? McDermott Family Foundation, ready? Frank and Janet Nessinger, ready? Randall Olson, ready? Virginia and Scott Ryman, ready? Justin and Scott Schwader, ready? Mary and George Sissel, ready? The Solich Fund, ready? Ann and Doug Sparks, ready? Bridget and John Greer, ready? How about a big round of applause for all of those sponsors? You can see all of our sponsors this year up on the screen and on the program on your table. So we appreciate them for being here in support of our mission. And now it's my pleasure to tell you about, you're about to meet two incredible women. They are smart, capable, talented, dedicated, compassionate, wonderful human beings. I'm going to introduce the first one, the board chair. Then she will introduce the executive director. Please welcome chairman of the board, chairwoman of the board, Courtney Hughes.
Thank you, Ms. Courtney. Thank you, Reggie. It's always a pleasure sharing the stage with you. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the JDC's 12th annual luncheon. I'm so thrilled to be together with all of you in this room after a couple years of virtual luncheons. And I'm especially excited about today's program. As many of you know, I lost my father to suicide when he was just 51 years old. This was the impetus for me to get involved in the Depression Center, as I loved the work that was being done around suicide prevention education and the destigmatization of mental health. Some of the most impactful work comes from hearing personal stories of survivors of suicide, and I want to thank Gina and Steve Meyer for their courage in being here today to share their story. And while I have spread my message as far and wide as I know how, I don't quite have the reach of our keynote speaker. There is something so powerful in hearing people like Brandon Marshall speak up and share openly and honestly about their mental health challenges. Doing so helps to alleviate the shame so many still associate with mental illness. Brandon, thank you for being here and for your continued advocacy to destigmatize mental health. Several years ago, I was facilitating a suicide prevention training, and one of the attendees was a woman who had just moved to Denver from New York. She told me that in Manhattan, people discuss going to therapy in the same matter-of-fact manner that they talk about getting a haircut or going to the dentist. She observed that here in Denver, people tend to be much more hesitant to mention therapy. My mother was a psychologist, so mental health was openly discussed in my house growing up. Then, as an undergraduate, I studied neuroscience, and I remember back then wondering why mental health was treated so differently from physical health, why it was so stigmatized, given the obvious neural changes in the brain. Although as a society we have made tremendous progress since the late 90s, we are far from where I hope we can one day be. To quote Kevin Hines, a Golden Gate Bridge suicide attempt survivor who shares his story in order to help others, addiction and mental illness are the only diseases where we blame the person suffering. I don't know why we do this, but I do know that we can work together to affect change, and that is exactly what you are doing by coming here today. So from the bottom of my heart, and in honor of my father's memory, I thank you for being here. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank everyone involved in planning this event. I am extremely grateful to our luncheon co-chairs, Angie Flug and Connie Wiegers, for taking the reins yet again this year. Kudos, ladies. I also want to thank the entire luncheon committee and Brittany Pittman, Kristen Woodburn, and Kristen's team for working tirelessly to plan such a fabulous event. And of course, none of this would be possible without tremendous support from the university. Most of the Depression Center faculty and staff are here today, and their dedication to changing lives is inspiring. I want to give each and every one of them a heartfelt thank you, and if you are sitting with someone from the JDC, please acknowledge the work that they do. Lastly, I'd like to express my deep gratitude to the entire JDC Advisory Board, whose passion for mental health advocacy is galvanizing. It is my honor to work alongside each of you. And with that, it is my privilege to introduce you Dr. Neil Epperson. Neil is the chair of the Department of Psychiatry at CU Anschutz Medical Campus and serves as the executive director of the Johnson Depression Center.
Thank you so much, Courtney. I just really love that you are always so willing to share your own personal lived experience. I also appreciate many of you don't know Courtney, but she is an exceptional leader. She is really thoughtful, organized, and just truly a fun person to work with. And so I've really enjoyed this year. Next year in July, Elizabeth Paris will take over as chair of the advisory board. And Elizabeth, wherever you are, I'm going to have fun working with you too. I also want to echo that Courtney was thanking people who have been so instrumentally involved in the success of this luncheon. This is an amazing feat. It's so beautiful. I came into the room and just got chills because it's so great to be back together. Just a few minutes ago, I guess I am proud to say that we've raised over $550,000 as part of this luncheon, and hopefully we'll raise more by the end. This week, yes. It's a big accomplishment. This is a banner year for this luncheon. This would not have been possible without our CU advancement officers, Marcus Palos and Melissa Staten. You guys have worked tirelessly to gain support for all of our missions here at the JDC. And then so many of you, I want to thank you, because you've given to this organization year after year. You really are passionate about promoting mental health care, supporting the kinds of community services that we do in education and trainings. I want to thank you so much. And for those of you that have given for the first time, welcome to the JDC family. We're glad you're here. So I also think that we need to recognize Dr. Christopher Schneck, who is our medical director at the JDC, and Dr. Matt Mishkin, who is our deputy director. I have to say that our success each year is really rests on their shoulders in so many ways. And then the clinical faculty and clinicians who basically provide care day in and day out, and our JDC staff, you guys, you really make the clinic hum, and you are our heroes. I also want to recognize several of our state leaders who are in the audience. I thank you for all that you do each day to fight for Coloradans to have access to quality mental health care in the right place and at the right time. We also have several members of the University of Colorado Board of Regents in our audience. You too have done so much, particularly over the pandemic, as I've gotten to know many of you. You've done so much to help our CU communities thrive. Again, please give a round of applause to these champions in our state for promoting mental health care. So as today's theme for this luncheon is tackling stigma, I want to share a personal story of my own. This story it really set me on a path to become a physician scientist. Over the past 25 years, I've become an expert in women's mental health care and a productive and thankfully well-funded researcher. So I've been able to really contribute new knowledge to the causes of mental illness, particularly as they occur in women across the reproductive lifespan. So this story starts with me as a third-year resident at Yale University in the Department of Psychiatry. I was referred, it was my outpatient year where we see people coming in with various concerns, and I was working for the University Health Service. So I got a referral for a Yale faculty member who was said to have postpartum depression. Now, you can understand that as a resident, this was my first patient that I had ever treated with postpartum depression. But I was a very good diagnostician, I have to say, and I actually started realizing that she had postpartum obsessive compulsive disorder. She was certainly distressed, she was certainly depressed, but this was because she was having intrusive thoughts about harming her children. These thoughts were in no way a part of a psychosis. She was completely rational. She knew the thoughts were uncommon, that mothers don't typically think that way. And she was terrified. She was so upset that she stayed away from her children, let the nanny take care of the children. And we all know that that's not particularly good for maternal bonding and infant development. So meeting with her, I started asking myself, why is it that when women experience onset of various psychiatric illnesses like psychosis or postpartum depression or these obsessive symptoms, why is it that it focuses on the mother-infant relationship in some way, shape, or form? A mother with postpartum psychosis might actually be delusional and hearing voices and believe that drowning her children is an act of compassion. Women with obsessive compulsive disorder may avoid their children because they're triggers for these unwanted thoughts, or they may have these perceived sense of danger for the infant, and so they do a lot of rituals and cleaning to protect the infant from germs and other perceived harms, and obviously that takes time away from mothering, and is also quite distressing. And every woman that I've ever met with postpartum depression over 25 years is ashamed. They are ashamed because they feel like they're supposed to be happy. As a matter of fact, they have relatives that look to them and say, wait a minute, I thought you wanted a baby. Your baby's so beautiful and healthy. Why are you so down in the dumps? Why aren't you playing with the baby and joyful? Don't say that. That is the worst thing to say, because the mother already feels terrible that she's not having this normal maternal experience. So why did I decide, after one patient encounter, to become a women's mental health specialist as a physician and a scientist? Well, frankly, I was just angry. I was angry that in the 1990s and early 2000s, that society conspired to make these women feel ashamed. So much so that they suffered in silence many times. I can't tell you how many times I had a woman in my office who was a year postpartum, and she was feeling depressed that entire year. We know that's not good for her. It's also not good for the offspring. This made me furious. We really shouldn't have to feel ashamed. I was also very angry that during my medical school training and psychiatry residency, no one had prepared me. No one had talked to me or any of my classmates about the importance of hormones and how they impact the brain. And the fact that postpartum depression is one of the most common complications of childbirth, occurring in 20% of new moms. I mean, how can you leave that out of my education? Are these female-specific problems not important enough? So I became a women's advocate, a women's mental health advocate, really wanting to make sure that women are not left out of these discussions, that in research studies, women are included because we are different and our brains are different than the man's brain. And we have to be thinking about this. I also began reading about the biology of maternal behavior. And I found out in the 1990s that the hormone oxytocin, which was recently in the press just a few weeks ago, oxytocin is critical for the initiation of something as complex as maternal behavior. That blew my mind, absolutely blew my mind. And I started studying about all the other hormones that are involved in these processes. And if you think about the female brain during pregnancy, it is bathed in these high levels of oxytocin, progesterone, estradiol, all these hormones, the stress hormone, cortisol, completely bathed in it. 9 months, 24 hours after delivery, plummets to your socks. It is amazing to me that the female brain can be that flexible that only 20% of women experience postpartum depression. Why not all of us? So the human brain is very flexible. And most of the time when women experience these problems in the postpartum, they have no idea that they're at risk. So how did this knowledge help me as a psychiatrist and propel me into this research career? First, as a clinician, I was able to tell my patients that there was a plausible biological reason that they were experiencing these particular unwanted symptoms at a time when they were supposed to be so happy. It had nothing to do with whether they were going to be a good mother. It was not a character flaw. I can't tell you the relief that you would see with these women when they would realize, oh, my hormones have something to do with this. Wow. That really is reassuring. I can be a good mother. They also are not alone. 20% of new moms experience this, so they're not alone. Those two things, a plausible biological reason for their symptoms, as well as the fact that they're not alone, did more to alleviate the shame and stigma of having this mood disorder at this time when, again, they were supposed to be happy. So as I end my story, I want to circle back to today's theme, tackling stigma. Gina and Stephen Meyer are here today to share their story as survivors of suicide in their family. They are tackling stigma. You will hear our guest, Brandon Marshall, discuss his lived experience. He is tackling stigma. I tackle stigma by focusing on the causes of these brain disorders that we treat. The mere fact that all of us are here today and support the Johnson Depression Center, we come here and we listen to someone's lived experience or many people's lived experiences. We raise money to support the mission of the JDC to provide treatment, training, and community engagement. And then finally, all of us sitting here right now, being in public, this is important. This tackles stigma. We are here, we are not ashamed to say that mental health care is important, that mental illness is critical to be addressed in our society, and that is tackling stigma. So I want to thank each of you for your continued support of the Johnson Depression Center. I want to thank you for sharing your lived experience and listening to the lived experience of others. You, all of you in this room, are our biggest advocates in tackling stigma. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Neil. Thank you, Courtney. And now we'd like to invite Gina and Steve Meyer to come on up and join us on the stage. And as Neil said, that tackling stigma is about having these conversations. We appreciate you guys being here today. We appreciate this young couple. We're going to have a conversation with them. Please have a seat. Steve. And so we're going to have a conversation about your daughter, Katie, and they are survivors of suicide, and Katie was a student at Stanford University. And could you just tell us about Katie?
She's going to start by telling you about Katie, but I just want to say one thing out of the gate. Number one, thank you for having us. Number two, we're not experts in anything. We're just Katie's parents, okay?
And we're learning as we go.
We're learning as we go, too.
Learning as we go. Katie was amazing. She's incredible. A wonderful daughter, a wonderful sister, teammate. Had a little swag to her, a little swagger, a little spitfire, mischievous. When she was little, like fearless, you know, jumping off trees, climbing. I mean, she had a twinkle in her eye, could light up a room, would start a dance party with you at any moment, sing as loud as she could at the top of her lungs in the car. She was fun. She's super fun, loved life, loved her teammates, very loyal, loyal friend. She had your back, and loved our family, you know, and loved school. I mean, it wasn't just soccer with her. She loved school.
From when she was little, she loved school, and she loved it in elementary school, junior high, high school. She loved her university as well. And she was more than just a soccer player. She was very smart and really friendly and really was quick to pick stuff up, and she was awaiting law school acceptance at her university. She was slated to do a TED Talk. Mm-hmm. She had earned a Mayfield Fellowship, which is a entrepreneurial program at Stanford awarded to 12 students. She started a podcast series with Facebook. And I don't say these things necessarily to say Katie could do all this stuff. I say it to, yes, bring awareness to the fact that we are trying to break the stigma. This does happen.
Yeah, she was a leader. She was a team captain.
It can happen with anybody.
Yeah, it can happen to anybody.
Right.
So she's a team captain, Stanford University, national champion.
Yes.
Decorated, great student.
Yes.
Involved, engaged. And so there was never any sign that she was having suicidal thoughts.
Not to us, no. Yeah.
No, no history of mental illness, nothing that was diagnosed. Nothing that we knew about. After she died, we found out she had received a disciplinary letter from the school. And it was something, picking up the pieces now and the breadcrumbs now and the digging we've had to do, she was dealing with it for 6 months on her own, carrying that burden, that heavy weight on her back by herself for 6 months.
Got you. And this is something that you guys have recognized is different than high school, mm-hmm. that a student is in college, they can get a disciplinary action or mm-hmm. any other interaction with the school, and the parents, you have no idea what they're dealing with.
Right.
Unless they tell you, you have no idea.
Right. Once they're 18, FERPA laws, HIPAA laws, you get no information, academics, their grades, disciplinary, even if they had to go to the hospital, if there's an injury. Anything. You don't get anything unless they tell you because of those laws. So you're left completely in the dark.
And you feel that that was a big factor
yeah.
in her suicide.
Yeah.
We do. Yeah.
Yeah. She's had to face challenges before. She's faced adversity before. And we've always been there to support her. We had her back. She knew that. You know,
right.
We were that safety net.
We were aware of that adversity she was going through.
Right.
Yeah.
And could help
so I think
do
when
our
this
best to
happened,
help guide her through that.
Yeah, she wanted to, I think, handle it on her own. She didn't want to be a burden. She didn't want to worry us. And we think she just thought it would get taken care of, you know?
Yeah. And perhaps even, you know, because we thought about this a lot since, you know, you have somebody like Katie. She knows that her parents have a perception of her. Usually she's telling us good news.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And this was not good news for her to tell us. Mm-hmm. And so...
Well, this was a kid. She had never gotten a detention before. She had never gotten in trouble before.
Right.
Never got sent down to the principal's office. So I think this was...
It was hard for her to...
It was hard for her to talk about this with anybody.
Right.
Yeah.
Just for a super achiever to even admit that she had made one failure, it was too difficult. Yeah.
Well, and I think that's what it is when you have. We've talked to our therapist about it. He said this is not uncommon with an athlete, an elite athlete, an elite mindset, a high achiever, someone high achieving in academics, and maybe it's not even athlete. Maybe they're. A concert pianist, you know, or any kind of at that level, this would be a tough thing to talk about, you know, because...
They're used to succeeding,
mm-hmm.
they're driven, they're
mm-hmm.
used to just being hyper-focused, ignoring mm-hmm. the crowd in a stadium and getting the job done and
mm-hmm.
getting to the goal,
mm-hmm.
and they may not have the coping skills in that moment to deal with something where it feels like their world is crashing down around them and
mm-hmm.
everything they've ever worked for and everything they have coming is in peril.
I'm gonna be taken away.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So you guys are here sharing your story
mm-hmm.
And you're doing other things to try to, what changes are you trying to make in the university system that would allow for you to have known that she had this disciplinary action?
Yeah.
Well, almost right out of the gate, after Katie passed away, we felt we had to do something because it was so shocking and unexpected.
We just kept
saying
over
and over,
how did we not know?
And the pain was so intense.
Yeah, how did we not know?
How did we not know this? We cannot have another family
go
through this, another young person go through this, another team, and the ripple effect, the school, her dorm mates, everything.
Yeah.
And we knew nothing, so we've come up with, Katie was a goalkeeper, and we've come up with something called Katie's Save, and students can opt into it. It's not required. We try to allow the student to have choice all the way. It's crafted in a way that's not oppressive to them. They can choose an adult they trust, The word parent does not exist in the in the two pages.
It's a designated advocate.
Correct, of someone they choose. And hopefully they'll never need Katie Save. Hopefully they'll enjoy their 4 years, 5 years, whatever it is on campus. But if they do find themselves in a situation, one of five areas, that if left unsupported, may spiral. They know that somebody has their back, someone they chose. And it empowers them, hopefully, and allows them to help themselves. Because you can have a university with all the mental health resources one could dream of, but if you can't get that student there, what good is it?
Right.
So we're just trying to build that little bridge, that little front-end safety net for these young people to have.
Gotcha. And so just for clarity, it's Katie's Save. And it's katiesave.org.
Yeah, katiesave.org.
Learn more?
So we've been working a little bit with the NCAA. We've had some meetings with their chief medical advisor, Dr. Brian Hainline. He loved that it was a front-end safety net is what he was calling it. We've been working with a little bit on the SACS side. We're trying to figure out how we can get this into the schools. You know, for athletes, but also for regular, just students, because it's hard. You know, they're that 18 to 24 age group. You know, science has said their brain is not fully developed yet, right? That prefrontal cortex, which is good judgment, rational thinking. So they seem to react more with the middle brain, which is the impulsive, irrational. So you have this conundrum, kind of, because they're adults at 18, they're sent away, they're in college, you know, it's their emerging young adults, yet they might not be, you know, they need that extra support, that extra guidance.
No matter how smart
or independent they may be. They are. So this would be, their designated advocate would get almost like an email blast saying, this student has been involved in an element of Katie's Save. And then that designated advocate would go to that student, and again, this could be an older brother, sister, aunt, uncle, a coach, whatever, and say, hey, I got an email, what's going on? Gotcha. And then they can, it opens the conversation. It starts the conversation. How can I help you? Where do we need to go? What are the next steps? You know, it's someone that's in their corner, so they're not carrying the burden alone.
Gotcha. And just to be clear about the front end safety net, like in Katie's situation, her designated advocate, had this existed, would have got that email right out of the gate. And then that could have been dealt with instead of allowing it to build up over 6 months. And I also like to use a different example away from women's soccer. Let's say it's men's football, okay? And there's a linebacker having a tough practice and the linebacker coach is on him. Well, if that coach had known that that linebacker has going through something, maybe the coach could pull that linebacker aside and say, hey, let's have a quick chat for a minute, right? And so that can be a life-changing practice, those two different paths that could be taken.
Right. And it seems like a fairly simple thing to add, because I know anybody who's taking your kid to freshman orientation, there's a lot of things that they have to do, and this is one of them. You know, they have to designate who's your emergency contact.
Right.
Well, who is your going to be your designated
advocate? Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Because if you wait until they need it, it's too late.
It's right.
Too late.
Right.
It'd be too late.
This would catch it on the front end. Yeah.
Tell us about the work you're doing, the advocacy work you're doing with the CU Depression Center.
Yeah. So Dr. Matt Mishkin, reached out to us at one point and told us what he was doing with suicide prevention training for athletic staff. And we were like, wow, that is a game changer. We had numerous Zooms with him. We finally met him up in Reno. We did a few trainings with him, and we were able to speak as well to, it was hockey coaches, figure skating coaches, and it was amazing. And we're like, okay, we need to bring this to like all campuses. Like, they need, just like CPR training, just like a mandated CPR training or first aid training, this should be a mandated training for all coaches, for coaching staff, right?
And we feel very strongly about that, and to help with that, because Katie's head coach at Stanford is a guy about my age, and he's married, he's got two kids, and he's shattered over this. And he said, like, not only am I their head coach, but I feel like I'm their father by proxy.
Yeah.
And so we would like to help in any way we can, because it's tough. You know, you have coaches giving their time and their energy and their heart to their sport, and there's a lot of great coaches out there. They could be doing many other things in their career, but they've decided to give their spirit and their selves to their sport and these kids. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be nice to help them a little bit too? Prevent them from having to feel this horrible ripple effect after the fact?
Right. Right. It was something we also brought to the NCAA, and we said, like, where does this fall in lines with their best practices? So they're looking at it, and we're, you know, keeping our fingers crossed that this is something that they will either mandate or require in some way, because it's not always the glaring red flags. Sometimes there's the softer vulnerability. Something might be going on where a coach can dig a little deeper, you know, whether it's academics, whether it's disciplinary, maybe there's something going on in their family, a divorce, maybe there's a relationship, breakup. So there's a lot of things to look at besides just the glaring red. Sometimes they're going through something,
right? And, you know, as parents, when our kids are young, we spend every day with them, we see them, we see every mood up and down, and so we're pretty attuned to any change in that. Mm-hmm. Now they're off in college, and it's different. As kind of a closing comment for everybody here, what would you recommend that people be looking for in order to help others?
I think really just really having those conversations, really talking. I know it's just not the checking in all the time, but looking at, it's not always, it's what I said, not always those glaring red flags. Sometimes there's other stuff going on, and we all need to dig, I think, a little deeper, and just ask those questions and have some of those tough conversations, you know?
Yeah, I mean, we communicated with Katie all the time. We were super close. I was supposed to go see her 2 days after she passed away. I would say in that same spirit, letting your young person know, like, it's okay to tell me bad news, because it's not easy for, we were young ones too, right? Mm-hmm. It's not easy to admit weakness or vulnerability, it's not. And so just let them know, like, it's okay, to share a little bad news, it's all right, we got you, we love you.
Yeah.
Gina and Steve, thank you so much for being here to share your story with us. Thank you. We appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you, sir. You bet. And as a reminder, you can learn more about the work they're doing by going to katiesave.org. katiesave.org. Thank you. Thank you again very much. Okay, so next up, we have a video that will showcase a new Depression Center initiative called Mental Health Moments. This video is intended to showcase the different perspectives of caregivers, clinicians, and individuals with lived experiences as they discuss the various mental health topics. This initiative was developed so that those with lived experiences don't feel so alone, to help decrease stigma, to demonstrate the impact of mental health that is multifaceted. I want to say thank you to the Johnson Depression Center Education Events Committee and the staff and community members who made this happen. So this video is a bit of a coming attractions showcase. It's a compilation of conversations around bipolar disorder, eating disorders, and suicide. You can see the full conversations online soon on the Depression Center website, but let's take a look.
I'm here today in honor of my son Patrick, who died in 2004 by suicide.
When it comes to bipolar, this is not something you can do alone, and that's okay. You know, it's the same as any other illness.
My daughter has anorexia. Being a parent has actually impacted how I look at this as a professional, and certain things that I've learned along the way that maybe I wish I had known also as a professional and doing this.
When Patrick went off to college, unfortunately, the fact that he wasn't with his friends and his family, he became very depressed. By the time he came home, he was not in a good state. And I knew something was really wrong.
We were on a family vacation and we were having, I believe it was salmon. and she took such a small portion. And I remember looking at her, and my wife kind of, I think, had the same thoughts, and we really then noticed the weight change. And we ended up that family vacation and immediately came back and started to look for services.
I wasn't diagnosed with it until I was about 20 years old. I have a sibling who was diagnosed with it 3 or 4 years prior to my diagnosis. And it wasn't until I was diagnosed with it myself after having gone through a manic episode that I understood, you know, just how significant of an illness this really was.
I kept beating myself up and letting the guilt just take over me, which finally I had to realize that is not your friend.
Oftentimes by the time parents get to us, they're down to having fights at home and really unpleasant times at the dinner table. They might be sitting at the table sometimes for hours while a teen or younger child refuses to finish. They're really frustrated, really angry. Family communication has really become very challenging, and they start to realize this may be more than we can do at home or without additional help.
There also is an element to it where I didn't feel safe.
What sorts of interventions, whether it's medications or other supports, therapies, have been useful for you in managing your symptoms?
I think medication is really important. Just as essential would be your willingness to kind of like advocate for yourself and for your mental health as a whole. Learning steps to get through it and say, okay, we've been here, we know we can get through this, and what are the coping skills that we have, and how can we actually help our daughter get through it as well.
Families are the most important people in a kid's world, and watching family-based therapy really come together is really, really powerful.
The parents surviving suicide was the most healing thing for me because it was a validation of other parents that loved their children, and we all were able to just talk about the stories, and I could see that maybe this wasn't that I was a bad parent. Maybe this was a lot more than that.
What we do know about, you know, suicide is the more we talk about it, the more communication there is, the more likely we are to have more awareness, ideally prevent suicide.
First you grieve the loss of your child, and then you grieve how they died. That's why I think suicidal grief is very complicated.
What do you say to parents to really give them hope in this process?
I can truly say to parents with full confidence that the majority of folks who have this problem go on to do really well. And I've seen so many people recover, you know, who had short duration of illness, longer duration of illness, 5, 10, even 15 years or more. You really can recover.
Eating disorders, it's still the one thing where people say, well, the person's doing it on purpose or they have some control of it. There is a stigma, but it doesn't need to be there. We do need to really think about it differently and see it for what it is, which is not something that somebody is choosing, and really focus on the illness that it is.
18 years later, we've come a long way, and we're having a discussion like this, which is all good.
At the end of the day, that disorder should not and does not define me. You know, it's something that I'm gonna have to manage for the rest of my life. It is complicated, but it is possible. It just starts with taking that first step.
And again, you'll be able to see the full videos on the Depression Center website very soon. Okay, so we've reached a moment in our program now where we want to invite all of you to become part of the CU Depression Center family and make contributions. We've got envelopes on the table. There are little pledge cards on the table. If all of you could pull those out, and once you get it out, let's hold it up in the air. Let's take some pictures to put on social media just to show everybody how generous everyone was here today. I just hold them up high. It doesn't cost you anything to hold them up. and while you've got it up in the air, just take a look at the size of the team that we have in this room. You know, we alone, any one of us can only do so much, but together as a team, we can really make a big impact on the CU Depression Center and the families that they serve. I know many of you have made a significant contributions already. You have purchased tables, you have made other gifts, and we appreciate that. And we just want to invite all of you to make a gift and enter it into there. And we don't want you to take this home with you. Don't put it in your pocket. Don't put it in your purse. We'd like to do this right now together as a team. And any amount that you want to donate will be greatly appreciated. But I do want to prompt you with a couple of levels that might be specifically meaningful. A gift of $5,000 would support up to 15 people becoming new Vital Cog trainers. And Vital Cog is part of a workplace training for construction industry and athletic staff, and they hope to expand it to healthcare providers, students, faculty, staff, and athletes. A gift of $3,000 would support a scholarship for one person or family to receive care. A gift of $1,000 would support the expansion of clinical best practices. Gift of $500 supports a training in the community. And a gift of $250 would support staff as they help to match patient needs with clinical services. And so gifts of all sizes are meaningful, and we're grateful for all of them, and we appreciate all of you as a team taking a moment to fill out those cards. I think there's an envelope in the center of your table. You can, once your card is filled out, you can put it into that envelope, and we'll have someone come around and pick them up at the end of the luncheon. But we appreciate all of you and your support. This isn't something that any one person can do by themselves. This is a team effort. It takes our whole community. It takes all of us in this room. As you saw when we held those envelopes up, there's a lot of us here. And together, we can make a big impact. And we appreciate your commitment and support. All right. Now it is my pleasure to move on to our keynote Q&A with Brandon Marshall. Brandon, I'm going to ask you to come on up here. And Brandon is a legitimate NFL superstar. You know, he played for the Denver Broncos for a few years, but he played a total of 13 years in the NFL. How are you, man? Good. Good. Have a seat on my couch.
Hold on now. Let me take over for a second.
Oh, go ahead. Yes, sir.
2006 drafted to the Denver Broncos. This guy used to come in and interview us. So just full circle now. You know, so many years later, being up here with you is awesome.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Love you. He was just a kid when I met him. Just a kid.
That's
but
right.
He was 6'5". And so, you know, any of you who have had the chance to meet Brandon over the past, you know, little bit here, you notice that it's like being next to an avatar, right, from the movie Avatar. You don't realize how big he is as a player. But just to brag on Brandon for a moment, for those of you who don't know all of his NFL career, Brandon Marshall is a legitimate NFL superstar. That he's in a class, like in the top 5, 10% of players who've ever played in the NFL. He played for 13 seasons, four of those with the Denver Broncos, and then went on and played for a total of 7 teams. Everywhere he went, he was a standout wide receiver. He was a dominating player. He was a 6-time Pro Bowler, was an All-Pro. I mean, was just a prototypical instant success in the NFL. I was talking to you earlier, and just, you know, I've been covering the team for a long time. I've seen a lot of rookies come in. Not most of them come in the way that did, as equipped physically and mentally to deal with the NFL. And so that's the NFL story of Brandon Marshall and the success. You might not know about his mental health journey, and that's what I want to talk to you about here today. What can you tell us about your mental health journey that we don't know?
Yeah, so in 2011, I was diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, and I spent 3 months in an outpatient program on the campus of McLean Hospital, number 2 psychiatric hospital in the world, I like to say. Big fan of them. Debatable. And that's where I really discovered, like, you know, why I was born. You talked about the football side of things. When I would get to the root of something during the work, whether it was in mentalization therapy, dialectical behavior therapy, self-assessment, didn't matter. Like, I would write, I would journal. And one of the things I wrote was, my pain, my sadness gives me my strength. My strength ruined my mind, body, and soul. I've been trapped all my life, not by man or cages, but by my own emotions. Where I've been while traveling inside myself can be summed up by one word, damn, right? I say that because as a football player, you know, like I played with this energy, I played with this aggression, I played with this tenacity, and it made me, you said it, not me, part of the 5-10%, probably 10-15% top athletes to come through our NFL, National Football League. But those same things were hurting me off the field or in my interpersonal relationships. And so it was here in Denver where I just struggled. You know, I was a young athlete and superstar, and I didn't have all the skills and all the tools I needed to be able to self-regulate with whatever was going on, good or bad, high or low. And I remember my last year in Denver, or my third year in Denver, so 2009, you know, there was weeks where I was speaking to four or five different professionals or clinicians. I ran by, I was running yesterday, I ran by a spot where PF Chang's is, and it was where I got arrested, DUI, right? And it was like, you know, all these different flashbacks came back, you know, when my time here. You know, I was a young boy, made a lot of mistakes, I was immature, and I wasn't developed. So 2011, you know, I was sitting in self-assessment, it's a form of group therapy. You literally sit in a circle, small group, 6-7 people maybe, give or take a few. You just talk about what's going on in your life and what's going on in your day. Never forget this day where, you know, we had one young lady sitting next to me, and she had a bandage on her arm, and there was blood seeping through. And when it was her time to talk, her turn to talk, she talked about self-harming. I never heard about self-harming before. And there was a lady next to her, when it was her time to talk, she talked about how she tried to take her life the night before. And we all went in a circle, and we had all these different stories. And I never forget just being in awe and standing up, walking out, because that person who was suicidal was an insurance broker. The person who was self-harming was a student. And I was this big macho football player, and I was going to Reebok's headquarters at the time to go train. And we walked out, and everybody was going back to their lives, getting in the car, and I took a photo of this. And it's like 200-300 cars in this parking lot, it felt like. It's like, man, how many other people are out there suffering or suffering in silence, and we don't know. Like, I'm about to walk down Main Street in Waltham, Massachusetts, and there's going to be people like I touch or walk by that may be dealing with depression or dealing with anxiety or bipolar disorder, and you have no clue. At the time, there wasn't a professional athlete like really standing up, pounding the pavement, and trying to use their platform to talk about these things. So that was the goal, was to, you know, help raise awareness and start putting faces and more faces and more voices to it. And that was 10 years ago.
Yeah. Take me back. How did you first get to counseling? Like, you're a man, you're in the NFL. In the NFL, guys are reluctant to admit they have a sprained ankle.
That's right.
Let alone that they're, you know, that something might be wrong with their mind. How did you first end up in counseling, and how did you have the courage to go?
Yeah, it's a double whammy. Not only a football player, but also an athlete, right? Like, we're trained to mask pain. You know, you better work through it. You better fight through it. And as men, you know, we're raised to be tough and not show any pain or emotions. And I always give this example, you know, a little boy falls down. What we tell the little boy, get up, be strong, boys don't cry. And that's a big challenge for us in our community. How I got help, getting in trouble, been in the National Football League, been in the system, right? That DUI, that was one of the people that I would talk to. So when you get in, you go into a program. And so I had to talk to someone once a week, and I had to, you know, I was in a drug testing program, et cetera, et cetera. So that was one person. You know, talking to Dr. McBride and teaching me how to count 1 to 10. Never forget living right here and off of C-470 in Quebec, maybe, if I can get my my area right, sitting in my house and doing one session with Dr. McBride and talking about 1 to 10. You know, just count to 10. No, well, count to 10. And I tried it after a tough practice. Coach Shanahan probably got on me or something. I was like, I tried to count to 10 and it didn't work. But it was that, but I wasn't ready. You have to be ready. You understand? So there's phases of it. You know, I was pointing a finger at everybody else. You know, you can't control what happens to you, but you can't control how you respond to it. And at the time, it was everybody else's fault why things was happening in my life. And it wasn't until year 5, year 6, where I finally, actually, it wasn't until I was on the campus of McLean Hospital where I stopped pointing a finger at everybody else and I said, okay, what can I do about this situation? Dr. Gunderson, great legend in this space. He's no longer with us, but Dr. Gunderson, he helped change my life forever. And we were sitting in just like this one day, and I was this person, that, and that person, that. Coach McDaniels, he came into the Denver Broncos and he ruined everything.
You're right. You're right.
I know. Our feelings are valid, right? But how we may respond to it may be off, right? So if you ever see me kick a football in Denver, it's because I was Coach McDaniels. But I didn't have the skills and tools to be able to self-regulate, right? So that's how I cope with it. Coach McDaniel said something wild, and I went out there, I said, okay, and I kicked the football, and it was, you guys were reporting on it. Brandon Marshall lost his mind again, right? But it wasn't until I was on the campus there where he said, okay, he started really challenging me. Well, how do you contribute to it? Why are you worrying about everyone else? What about you? And then in that 3-month stay, it was that halfway mark where I finally had that breakthrough, and I stopped pointing the finger at everyone else. And I start looking inward, and that's when everything took off for me.
Gotcha. So interesting to hear you, your story. You were in counseling long before you were ready.
That's right.
To move or understand what it was.
4 years.
Yeah. And so it's not a magic bullet. It's not like, hey, I'm going to go to 1 or 2 counseling sessions. Yeah. It's like this conversation starts, and the conversation gets deeper, and there becomes a moment where you're ready.
That's right. I mean, you have to want help. Right? Like we can do, and that's the tough part about all the work that you guys do and even your contributions is like, you know, not everyone makes it. And we obviously, you know, just heard a powerful story, you know, and then also you can do everything for your loved one and they're not in a position to receive it. So yeah, you have to be ready and you have to do the work.
Right. You said another thing that I just made a note about, that we in the media, we would say, Brandon has lost his mind again.
Yeah.
And that's very common. Like,
that's right.
When I think about the Antonio Brown situation where he walked off the field, took off his uniform, and what we in the media said about him,
that's right,
was really not having any kind of recognition or sensitivity about the mental health challenge that people are having, and just kind of labeling this whole manly thing, hey, you're tougher than that sprained ankle. You're tough. Get your mind right. You shouldn't be doing that.
That's right. Yeah, the media plays a huge part in it. You know, that's why it's important for people like myself to make sure that we're pushing the conversation forward, we're controlling the narrative or making sure people are being responsible with whatever their narrative is. You know, you have Dak Prescott comes out and say, I'm struggling. You know, I lost my brother to suicide. Had to look at myself, you know, for a long time of how I'm going to move forward. I didn't want to come out of my house, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then you have Skip Bayless that comes out and he says, you're the quarterback of America's team, the Dallas Cowboys. What do you mean you don't want to move forward? And what are you talking about, right? And so it's tough at times when we see the media and how they respond to certain situations. So, you know, we have a job to do, but also at the same time, you know, this is why, like, I love what you guys are doing, Jenna and Gina and Steve. Like, it's important, right? Like, being able to give our athletes and all students, you know, resources on campus, because 18 to 22 is when we typically see that first break, right? And it's peer-to-peer, and it's, You know, we're going to go to the people that we believe in and that we trust the most. So a lot of work needs to be done still, but it is in a different place. That was August 4th, 2011, when I stood in front of the world. I was like, hey, I just left McLean Hospital, diagnosed with borderline personality disorder. Moving forward, we want to walk the halls of Congress. We want to challenge insurance companies to cover it differently. You know, we need more athletes and entertainers to step up. Where we're at in the cancer community was where we're at in the mental health community is where the cancer community was 20, 25, 30 years ago. I thought it was going to take forever to see Naomi Osaka, Simone Biles, and the Kevin Loves of the world and the Dak Prescotts of the world stand up and say, me too. So we're in a phenomenal space right now. So I think we have to continue to push the conversation forward, but now it's time, like, you know, your contributions matter because there's going to be more people looking for help because we're talking about it. So do we have the resources? Do we have the hospitals and the institutions to be able to help people? So now, like, you know, the work that you guys been doing for years, you know, you guys better be ready because over the next few months to few years, you're going to start seeing more people stand up. Me too, me too, me too, me too. But we've always known this, right? We just never had the space to say it.
Yeah. So 2011, mm-hmm. you're coming out, you come out of the hospital and you're basically 100% transparent about what you're going through, what the diagnosis was. Where did the courage come from to be that transparent, and were you worried that it was going to harm your career?
Yeah. I'm glad I was, like, maybe that's part of the diagnosis and the mental illness, because I was just fearless. And I say that because now I look back, I'm like, man, it's tough at times. Like, even in business, and I heard your story. Is it Flog?
Fluke.
Like, you said Fluke. And thank you guys for hosting last night. It was awesome, beautiful home. It's great. But, like, listening to you saying, like, I'm living with this forever. You know, I'm going to have to deal with that forever. And it hit me because, you know, that was 2011. And that now, as an entrepreneur businessman, you know, when I go out, whether it's I'm sitting down with networks, I'm sitting down with investors, right, that always comes up. So it's with me forever, the good, the bad, the ugly, you know. So I wouldn't change it. I wouldn't change it at all, but it's definitely something that, you know, is going to be with me forever and I'm going to live with. And it was on the campus of McLean Hospital, one of the most phenomenal professionals in the space, Marsha Linehan. She came out with her personal story while we were there. I never forget that day. We're sitting in, like, group therapy, and this New York Times article comes out, like, Marsha Linehan also, you know, diagnosed with borderline personality disorder back in 1980 something or 70 something. And back in the day, like, I mean, her story had her in straitjackets and things like that. And I was angry. I was upset because, you know, we're sitting here and we're in dialectical behavior therapy, this therapy that she helped pioneer and bring together. And I was like, why didn't you tell your story already? You know how many more lives you would have saved? You know, and I have a phenomenal relationship with Marsha Linehan and her whole team, but this is just my real feelings, and that's how a lot of people felt on campus, right? Because you guys, the clinicians and donors, you guys can say whatever you want to say, but the real connection is when a patient stands up and say, like, this is my experience, that's when you're like, oh, I'm not alone, or there's other people out there like me. So that first day or two on campus, going to a workshop and hearing from my peers or other patients, that was the most powerful thing. Because I thought it was just me. You know, I didn't know what borderline personality disorder was. So, you know, when that article came out, that's when it, like, really, like, charged me up to do something and say something. But I was going to do it regardless because, like, I went from, you know, just like, this is the picture. This is how it was with the Denver Broncos, right? So phenomenal game or whatnot, and then I would go home and I'd be like this. You know, family comes in, you know, millions of dollars or about to walk into millions of dollars, could do whatever. Hell, people in the community wouldn't even let me buy a steak at times, you know, so life was great, right? And then I'd just be like this on the couch. Family comes in, hey, son, hey, you know, brother, you know, friend, right? It was just like, I didn't know what was going on. And so going to McLean Hospital and then going through this program and a month and a half through it, just like, hey, smiling, going to, like, a big thing for me was going to a Red Sox game and having a beer and a brats. Like, I would never do anything like that. It was like, wow. Going to a hockey game, doing new things, I was like, oh, my goodness. I went to AA meetings with other people. I wasn't dealing with any substance abuse, but, like, you have this bond and this, like, comes to life, the people that you're going through this program with. And so some people were dealing with substance abuse or dual diagnose. And so I would go to other programs with them. Never do that. Like sitting in AA meetings and, you know, going through that process. It was phenomenal. And so that's the thing that charged me up the most is because I was like, man, you know, other people need this, right? I never thought that I would be in this position so quickly, and so that's why I wanted to do, to launch, you know, Project 375.
Okay, let's get to that. Two things. Once my NFL career ended, I started eating things that I had never eaten before, too.
Right.
But on a separate note, just sitting here listening to him talk, you can see why he was a successful NFL football player, right? And this is what NFL football players, basically the basic DNA of a successful NFL football player is driven, focused, no matter what it is. And so, you know, I didn't know all the struggles that you were having. I remember covering you and being around you all the time in the media. My impression of you at the time was incredible performer on the field, super affable guy off the field, always in a good mood, always friendly, always kind, always whatever. But it just kind of speaks to, we don't know what's actually happening in people's lives. And people can become very good at masking what the challenges are to get through the situations.
Right. Right.
And unless we're really looking and really asking and really starting conversations, it could be, you have the talent to be able to mask it so we can't see it.
Well, that's what makes us great high performers, whether it's an athlete or some of you businessmen and women here are phenomenal weekend warriors, at-home dads, at-home moms, like, do a phenomenal job. It's the ability to push through, perseverance, right? You know, look at Tom Brady going through a divorce now. Like, they've been struggling for a year or two, but Tom Brady still wins Super Bowls. Tom Brady is still, you know, performing at a high level. They lost the other night, but he still threw for 325 yards. How do you do that? And then the next day, or last night, was it? It was last night. And then this morning, you announced to the world that, you know, we're separated. The divorce is final. Like, those are the things that makes us great, is like being able to, no matter what's happening off the field, to still perform at a high level. But when the lights are off and the cameras aren't in front of us, what's going on,
right?
And that's why, like, all of this work is important, because we have to highlight, you know, the good and the bad and have a plan in place.
Tell us about what you're doing now, because you're not sitting still. Now you're out of the NFL. What are you doing in terms of advocacy?
Well, now a lot of my work is through for-profit. Like, I studied, like, in 2014, I spent 3 months at Harvard building out a case study on transition, and we studied Magic Johnson, Keanu Reeves, Boomer Esiason, Doug Flutie, Liv Strong, Lance Armstrong, to name a few. But these are all athletes that they built something in the nonprofit space or in the community that transcended sports, okay? And that's what I was looking at. Like, how do we become what Liv Strong and Lance Armstrong became in the cancer community? 36 million Americans that make up the cancer community, and it's almost 100, you know, that make up our community when you think about mental health. And so, you know, trying to galvanize our community, come together, have one voice, one mission, platform, and push it forward because of the stigma around it. So we did a lot of work on the nonprofit side, you know, and I was sitting down, like I went to like Under Armour and I was like, look, I'm making $10 million a year. You want to pay me $200,000-$300,000? That's not going to change my life. I'd rather you keep that money, invest it into a product line, take that product line the same way Nike did with the yellow and Live Strong, and let's bring to life something that people will invest in, be proud to wear, and then in turn, let's take that those resources and invest in, you know, my nonprofit and other nonprofit, because our nonprofit was more on awareness. Our goal was to raise a lot of money and fund people who are doing this work, the experts in this space. I love what you said, Steve. It's like, we're not experts, we're figuring this out, right? Like, you guys are the experts. Let's fund the experts. So, long story short, you know, dealing with big brands and companies, like, and this may be the athlete in me as well, like, I like $100,000, like, do all this work and you raise $100,000, it's like, man, that's my payroll for the year, or that's my COO's salary. Like, it's not big enough. This is global conversation. I want global impact, right? I want to raise $10 million a year, $20 million a year. So what I start focusing on and pivoting to is for-profit and business. And it's harder, and it's a struggle to build out teams and hiring people and putting in processes and all those things. So we launched 3 years ago House of Athletes, a for-profit, it's a wellness brand. We have some of the top athletes in the world trading at our facility. We'll scale that. We're launching online. And we have this mental fitness pillar where we're pushing our athletes and also adult fitness members to, you know, these resources. And that's where we're seeing the biggest impact. So we launched that, and we launched some of the products as well. And we'll, the same case study, same plan that I presented to Under Armour took it, but I presented it to Nike and also Adidas. We're now doing it ourselves with our own brand and our own audience, and we're selling out in 24 hours, right? Well, hey, we're making it drop 2,000, 10,000 pieces. Sold out in 24 hours. Wow. So it's cool to see how things are coming back full circle. So now we can take those resources and do the things that we wanted to do 5-6 years ago, and being able to fund, some of the most amazing researchers or nonprofits, individuals in the space. Right. So I see us in 3 to 5 years as a billion-dollar company, global, doing amazing things. We launched our own shows and our own platform, you know, turned into a cultural social phenomenon, hitting 1 million subscribers, you know, in 12 months. It's been awesome. So, you know, I think it's the consistency and just staying true to the mission and understanding, you know, who we are and what we want to do, and everything going back to that one thing, and that's mental health, mental health. I know I gave you guys the long answer when you asked me, what am I doing now? It's a lot.
Yeah,
but it's working, and I'm excited because this is something that we put in, we start thinking about and talking through in 2011.
I saw a social media post that said that men are more likely to start a podcast than to seek treatment.
That's so true.
You've done both. How do they compare?
Oh my goodness. Well, I need a lot of therapy building out podcasts and doing all these other things. Working with other talent. Now I look back and I'm like, man, was I this bad as talent and as an athlete, like building out teams? I'm like, I feel so bad for some of these coaches and owners. I put them through some things. So, it is hard doing it, and we're lucky. I think we hit it at the right time, but think about it, you know. And I say it, sometimes it's like hard because it's clinical and it's like the stigma around what we're doing. And that's why I'm going on a for-profit side, and then even on the media side, the conversations that we have, because it's like people come in, they want to hear about sports, they want to hear about these other things, and in these little conversations, whether it's with Deion Sanders or Dez Bryant, we ask, how are you doing? 1 to 10. Personally, professionally, mentally. Deion Sanders opens up. Well, a lot of people, nobody knows, has never shared this. This is Deion Sanders, by the way. And he says, in the height of my career, sitting in a hotel in Cleveland, going from playing football in one day into baseball in the next, I was sitting in my hotel, suicidal, about to take my life. Wow. You know, Dez Bryant breaks down crying. You know, I was admitted to the hospital 10 times. No one knew that. We're talking about mental health. So, like, we'll have 60 minutes of conversation, and then we may take 10 minutes, and you'll have these legendary moments about mental health. So it's just been an awesome experience just to be able to kind of get to what I want to get to.
What do you think about the NFL's progress in terms of taking mental health seriously, making it more accessible, decreasing the stigma?
I think it's real for most, and for some, it would be good business. In 2014, I was playing for the Chicago Bears. I wore lime green cleats. It was a Thursday night football game, and they fined me for wearing it, and it was a big deal. And now, you know, and that was part of the work. Like, so you'll see, like, you know, back in the day, it was just like pink cancer for Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And, you know, we really challenged the NFL to open it up for other causes. So you're seeing guys, whether it's in mental health or if it's for education, utilizing that platform. So you have that, you know, where there's a big initiative even through that platform, My Cause, My Cleats, where guys are really highlighting mental health. And also, some of their biggest partners are focused on mental health, and they're looping us in on those conversations and keeping it organic. So we go from finding, you know, finding me to now bringing me and saying, well, how do we approach this in an organic and a authentic way? Right? There's millions of dollars coming in. What do we do with it? So I do think it's real for a lot of people, and for some, it's just good business. And I was talking to some of the team in the back, and it's like, you know, when you're right physically, mentally, performance increases. So why wouldn't you invest in it and take advantage of the platform? So in the NFL, if I'm being honest too, they've always had great resources. It's just like we don't utilize them sometimes.
Right.
You know, so I think the NFL is on the right path.
Yeah. It's hard to.
And you know, I'll be honest.
Yes.
Okay.
I do know. I do know that. I agree that they have resources, and I think it's hard for guys to access them because, you know, there's the old maxim, you can't make the club if you're in the tub, meaning if you're in the training room too much, you're not going to be on the team. So it does, even if you have a legitimate, my shoulder is really acting up. It's like a test of your manhood.
That's right.
That's like, well, are you going to practice today or not?
That's right.
Because if you're not going to practice today, maybe we don't need you. You're like, no, I'm good. I think I could practice. I'm good. And so you muscle through it. And so I think on the mental health side of things, it's even so much more of a stigma because it's not visible to anybody. It's not, they can't just, oh, yeah, your shoulder is really injured.
That's right. No, it's a real thing. It's funny. When I got to the Denver Broncos, sitting in there, you got the Greek working on you, and you're like,
and he's not saying the Greek in a pejorative way. It's his Steve Antonopoulos, his nickname was the Greek.
Yeah, right. And he'll come in, and the vets will come in, but can't make the club on the tub, Rook, right? So that's the language that we speak over each other. And that's what I mean by, like, you know, men and athletes. It's like this, you know, trained to, you know, mass pain or push through. You think about some of the biggest moments in sports or some of the stories that we love telling. Michael Jordan, a flu game. He goes out there and he drops 50 points, but he had the flu. Or Kobe Bryant, he finishes a free throw after he tore his Achilles. Like, we highlight that stuff,
right.
You know? So it is important for us to push the conversation, continue to push the conversation forward because, well, it's here. The problem now is because it jumped on us so quickly over the last 3 years, you know, all these you know, really good athletes standing up saying, you know, I'm struggling with this. We're reactive and not responding, you know. So we got to get our athletes, you know, to have the right plans and programs in place to be able to continue to do their job and continue to live their life in an effective way. You know, now it's like, I'm feeling something. I don't know what to do. And they shut down. And now we're trying to figure out what's next. And we should already have that in place.
Gotcha. We're winding almost out of time. How can people find out more about what you're doing now? Where can they go?
Instagram. I'm a content creator, y'all. I'm a YouTuber. He said all these amazing things about me and football, blah, 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 blah. And now I'm a YouTuber. I walk around, Rich, and they don't come up to me and talk about the 21 catches or playing for the Broncos or, you know, being on Showtime inside the NFL. They walk up to me and say, I love your show on YouTube, right? So I say that because I'm a storyteller now, and that's always what that's what I've always wanted to do when it comes to this space. So, you know, a lot of that shows up there, and it's like every single day we're talking about something. So houseofathlete.com, Instagram, and you'll see a lot of the stories that we're telling. A lot of it pushes back to mental health. So we're doing some, our team is doing some exceptional work there. And just continue to follow the journey. Like, you know, we will be a global brand. We're going to utilize our pro athletes that train in our facilities that are adopting our services and our products to leverage their platforms as marketing assets to scale to the masses, right? Like when you walk into a House of Athlete and you see, you know, the Odell Beckham Juniors of the world or the Ja Morant or, you know, Shaquille, the retired player and his sons training at our facilities and all these other legendary athletes. We had Aaron Judge train at our Tampa location and they're adopting these pillars and these programs. Why wouldn't you adopt it either? You know, I mean, why wouldn't you adopt it as well? Like this is, you know, now I won't get into the business side, but we're more conscious now than ever as people. Yeah. You know, we're label readers. We're curious about how we should be training or moving, how we should be eating. And I look at us as the healthiest people on the planet. That's why I talked about, you know, Tom Brady. You know, like Tom Brady is dealing with things. We all deal with things. And that's what it is. Sometimes we go through life trying to put up walls instead of boundaries. And you put up walls, that's when you hurt yourself. Not my family. My family, there's no way we're going to have financial struggles. No way we'll go through a divorce or our marriage will be in ruins. There's no way my children will be sick or no way, you know, disease will hit us, right? No, that's the problem. We need to have boundaries. So I look at some of these top performing athletes, Serena Williams. Think of, you know, we talked about postpartum earlier. Just imagine what she's been going through over the last 5, 6, 7 years, but still able to go out there in Wimbledon and perform at a high level. So how do we take, you know, these attributes and these routines and this lifestyle of, from athletes and modify it for everyone? You know, like when I walked into the Denver Broncos facility or the Jets facility, you know, I had everything there, everything. Trainers, mental health practitioners, nutritionists. It was easy. How do I fail? It was literally there. I hurt myself tonight, 1 o'clock in the morning, the plane lands, they're taking me to the doctor. Like, so how do we take from that and open it up for everyone else to participate? And that's the fundamentals of life. I mean, fundamentals of health. A lot of us are working on building major hospitals and working on these huge problems, but what about just teaching people how to hydrate? Athletes, you walk into the Nuggets or the Rockies facility, you're gonna see guys carrying jugs of waters. It's our lifestyle. Performance decreased by 25% if we're dehydrated, right? The brain literally starts detaching from the skull when you're dehydrated. What is happening to us, our hormones, our emotions? What about if we're not sleeping properly? We have sleep specialists come talk to us about sleep. When last time you guys had a sleep specialist talk to you guys? right? Aura Ring is a good brand, you know, can teach you guys a lot of things, but if there's a lot of us that it's cool, grind time, I got 4 hours of sleep, we're building, 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 but what's happening there?
Right.
Right? Nutrition, every time we put something in our mouth, our body has a chemical reaction. You know, so as athletes, these are things that we have to figure out every single day. It's unbelievable. And it's not about doing it one time. It's about doing it for a career. And you know this.
Right.
So to me, there's a huge opportunity in teaching people the fundamentals. Could we see a healthier world, healthier children, healthier marriages, if we actually honed in on the fundamentals? And we just happen to do that extremely well.
Right. Brandon Marshall, thank you very much, man. This is great. Thank you. Great. Thank you, Brandon. We appreciate you sharing your story, sharing your wisdom. As you know, super charismatic guy. That's he always has been. And in this audience, we have a lot of well-educated people. So earlier, when he said that Dr. Matt asked him to count to 10, you guys understood that you're angry. You count to 10 before you. You didn't think that he was trying to teach him how to count to 10. It's part of the stigma that we have as football players. And you know, Instagram and YouTube, I mean, some of the younger people in the room understand this. You know, you can be on a network, you could be on CBS4, you could be doing a show every week on CBS4, and that show gets 15,000, 20,000 viewers a week. You make a video and you put it on YouTube, and you might have 1 million views in a week, and 5 million views in 2 weeks, and it's really where our young people are getting their information from is Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, and the content creators who are making valuable content on this kind of subject matter. They have tremendous influence. And so, you know, when he says he's a YouTuber, it kind of sounds funny, but he has a chance to have much more impact broadcasting on YouTube than on any of the traditional platforms of broadcast. Okay, so I want to thank all of you for being here. We appreciate your support of the Johnson Depression Center. This is the 12th annual. Next year will be the 13th annual. We hope to see all of you come back and join us. Please enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you very much.
baby's a sailboat captain at sea. We don't give a damn, we do as we please. My baby's a sailboat captain at sea. My gal is a good one, tails, but she's mine. Wish I'd better looking, baby, don't mind. My gal is a good one, tails, but she's mine. All I ever wanted was to make you happy, give you the truth, and then to make you love me, and I'm all that you do. My baby's a sailboat captain at sea. We don't give a damn what we do as we please. My baby's a sailboat captain at sea. My gal is a good one, tells me she's mine. This shot's like a looking baby on mine. My gal is a good one, tells me she's mine. My baby's a saint just like an old George. Good with a dagger and skilled with a sword. Although she's not, she's all that more. All I ever wanted was to make you happy. Spit it all out. Yeah, and then to make me love you. Yeah, let's not do it now. But you were in my head. We were in your bed. You said, yeah, I'm so fucking sorry for this. Lord knows where she goes, she's gone. Say you don't mean that. Lord knows where she goes, she's gone. Say you don't mean that.
Da da
da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da da. All I ever wanted was to make you happy. Give you the truth. Anything to make you love me. Any more than you do. My baby's a sailboat captain at sea. We don't give a damn, we do as we please. My baby's a sailboat captain at sea.